Hey, what's going on, everyone? Welcome back to another exciting episode of Primetime News. We have a lot of stuff to go over today, as usual, but we are going to start off with one of, if not the biggest scam I have ever covered here on the channel. This is a $1 billion scam, and it affected people on eBay and Amazon. In fact, it might have affected you. I'm going to show you how you could check if you might have been a victim of this. All right, so as you can see here, CEO arrested for selling $1 billion, yes, billion, not million, in fake Cisco hardware on Amazon and eBay. Now, if you're not familiar with Cisco, it's a big company that produces and sells all sorts of computer software, hardware, telecommunications equipment, and other types of products. And as you might expect, those products can be pretty expensive. So if you look here, this Cisco firewall is $2,307.06. Now it's advertised as a little bit of a discount because the condition is said to be refurbished. But here's the problem. When you purchase refurbished electronics, you as the consumer believe that you are buying the actual product and the model that's listed there with the specs that are listed. You could see all the different specs and the numbers and letters that advertise the model. Well, what this CEO is alleged to have done, now his name is Onar Ron Axoy. I'm going to emphasize at this point that these are allegations. He was arrested in Miami, but there hasn't been a trial yet and he hasn't been convicted. So keep that in mind. But there are serious allegations that he was involved in importing thousands of fake Cisco networking devices from China. So these were lower end models that were typically previously discarded by people. And then he had these people in China, basically, according to the allegations, modify them to make them look like they were new by putting in unauthorized software and low quality, sometimes defective, unreliable computer parts. And then they were putting unauthorized, inauthentic labels, stickers, and documents on and inside the boxes and on the equipment to make it look like that they were these newer models. So the $1 billion number comes from $1 billion in terms of retail value of this amount of product that is said to have flooded the market. And then he was profiting, you know, at least $100 million or more, according to allegations, of all of these different sales. And these sales took place over a lot of different sites with a lot of different company names. So you could see here, a lot of these companies were under what were called the name the Pro Network Companies. Now, one of them was called Pro Network LLC, but then he had another one called NetTech Solutions, Target Network Solutions, Easy Network LLC. So this is just an example. They're all, you know, designed to sound professional. And even the websites were designed to look professional. Like you can see here, this is one of the websites, this Pro Network one. So some of these were sites that were separate from Amazon and eBay, but then you could see here there were Amazon storefronts, and there were a lot of them. Albus Trade Hub, Easy Network US, Get Better Trade, and then there were a lot of them on eBay. Connect WUS, Future Tech Needs, Get Better Trade, Get On Trade. There's many of them. I'm going to put a link. This is from the Department of Justice. I'm going to put a link to it in the description section because you want to definitely look over your prior purchases and make sure you didn't buy one of these pieces of equipment, because what was happening is that eBay and Amazon, their sites were getting flooded with complaints by consumers about this equipment and that it wasn't working. It was causing their devices to break. Some people are said to have spent about $10,000 in repair attempts from all of the damage that was caused by some of these defective hardware pieces that were sold to them. Now, this scam went on for a long time, and it went on from at least 2013 to 2019, or even maybe a little bit more recently. And this company was being sent cease and desist letters from Cisco There were shipments that were being seized by the government, but this guy was using aliases, as you could see here. He also used the name Dave Durden or Ron Axoy, and he did all sorts of things to evade being arrested. So, you know, really took a long time to put this case together and to arrest him. But you, again, you definitely want to make sure you check into this because it could be real important for your, you know, for the computer products that you purchased. So a very serious case, very bad scamming case. I'm very big on consumer protection. So stories like this are always going to be one that pop up in the lead for me here. So let me know in the comment section what you think about this story and how this guy was able to get away with this for so long. And if you were actually affected, if you know of any of these companies, if you ever bought from any of them, definitely let me know that in the comments. All right. Now, one of the topics we've talked a lot about on the primetime news is retail theft, including theft inside of thrift stores. But there's also theft that occurs outside of thrift stores, but still on thrift store property. That's typically in the donation bin area or any other area outside the store where someone would leave a donation, such as right outside the front door. Well, it's important to remember that those items still belong to the thrift store, even though they haven't been taken inside yet by a worker. As soon as someone drops it off and donates it, it is property of the thrift store. So it's not a free sourcing opportunity to go to and just start grabbing stuff off of it and then go try to resell it somewhere or just use it for your own personal use. Well, a worker at a thrift store found on video that there was someone repeatedly going to the donation bin and taking items and just going off with it. Well, to act as a deterrent, what the person did is posted these videos onto TikTok and got all sorts of views. Well, wait until you hear here what the person who was caught on video taking all of these things from the bins decided to do when writing to the thrift store worker.
Did you see her put her hood down trying to hide after she had her face shown?
An accused thief is now threatening to sue Jared Smith, who works at the Kalinga thrift shop, after he released a video of her taking things on TikTok. Smith says he received a long Facebook message from her. She was cussing and threatening him that she's lawyering up and suing him for posting the video of her taking things from the store's drop-off area.
It was quite irritating to me. In our alley, it's clearly posted that they're being surveillanced, and so they can't have any, you know, thought of privacy in that alley. So I'm really not worried.
So how many times has the same person been caught on camera helping herself to items that don't belong to her? Smith says a lot, but she slowed down after he started posting the videos online. Smith says people come by and take things about 7 times a week. And he says even people in nice cars are driving up and grabbing whatever they can. He believes people are reselling the items, but either way, he says no one should be taking from what the thrift shop is recycling and trying to pour back into its own community.
All right, so I don't think that this thrift store worker has anything to worry about legally, but I just wanted to share with you how ridiculous it was that someone who was caught on video stealing stuff from the thrift store then threatened to sue the person who caught them stealing the stuff. Unreal. Now, speaking of public service messages, one of the most important public service messages I could tell you is to make sure you lock your back door. Now, lock all your doors when they are not in use, but particularly the back door, because a lot of people forget it, and it's a frequent access route by criminals, including violent criminals. In fact, some of the most violent crime stories I have ever read, the access point was through that back door. And when later interviewed and the criminals were asked, if the back door was locked, would you have still tried to find a way in? And they say, probably not. And they would have gone to a different house, for example. Now, in this story, we actually have a UPS driver that was caught trying to burglarize a house. And then there was another house in the area that he tried to access, but he wasn't able to. But this person was actually caught in the house with a package by the homeowner's daughter. And then when confronted, the UPS guy ran out of the house. He eventually was caught, again, was arrested. But, you know, it again, just serves as a reminder. The other thing that's important is that when you're interacting with your postal delivery carriers, whether it's USPS, UPS, or whomever, FedEx, really important to be careful and not showing off, like, you know, massive collections in the background or, you know, really valuable types of items that may lead your house to be a target, because sometimes that's all that is needed for you to then become a mark and potentially a victim in the future. So a lot of stuff in this story that's important to know and just keep in mind for safety reasons. All right. Now, just last week, I asked a question, when are these companies going to learn who partner with USPS to transport and deliver mail to international and domestic locations, not to submit false delivery claims? Well, apparently it's going to take longer. Last week, we were talking about a multi-million dollar settlement by Air France, and this week it's Delta Airlines, a $10.5 million settlement for allegations of submitting these false delivery claims. Now, I'll emphasize again, just like I did last week, it's a legal settlement, so they're not admitting to any wrongdoing, but they're settling to avoid protracted litigation. But according to the allegations, there were false delivery scans submitted. And the reason why these companies keep allegedly submitting these false delivery scans is that according to the terms of the original contract, there's going to be a fee that they're going to have to pay if they don't deliver the items on time or if they deliver it to an alternate incorrect location. And so it's a very short-sighted strategy to avoid a fee in a small fraction of cases, presumably. And then it just goes to show what we always talk about. It just doesn't make sense to cheat, because eventually it all catches up to you. And here you go, a $10.5 million legal settlement. All right, now here's an update to this story. An Indianapolis man pleaded guilty to killing a USPS carrier over delayed mail in April of 2020. Now, the story is a little bit more complicated than that. Yes, the man was upset over delayed mail. He was repeatedly asking her from a neighbor's porch to deliver him this delayed mail. Well, it sounds like the verbal confrontation just continued to increase. And eventually, the woman USPS carrier sounds like she felt threatened because she pulled out mace and sprayed the guy in the face with it. Well, he got upset over that, and his response was to pull out a gun and shoot her in the chest and kill her. She was 45 years old. So as a result of that impulsive action, he now faces life in prison. The sentencing will occur at a later date, and if I see news coverage of it, I'll cover it for you and let you know what happened. But just an absolutely senseless way to go. All right, another USPS story. They have jumped into the NFT market, non-fungible tokens, also known as digital collectibles. These are not real stamps that you could actually redeem as postage. These are purely digital collectibles. There are a lot of people that do have these digital collections, and USPS wisely, I think, figured, hey, there's a lot of people who just collect regular tangible stamps that they never plan on using. So why not offer a digital collection? They charge $6 per stamp. I'll show you some examples of them. And this is what it would look like if you, you know, made the purchase. It's a lot more than a forever stamp is going to cost you. So, you know, from a financial perspective, again, it makes sense. The only thing that doesn't make sense to me is that they're charging $6 per stamp, no matter how many are available in the edition. So, you know, some have 5,800 available, some have 4,800 available, this one has 3,800 available. And normally the practice is that when there's a lower quantity available for an NFT, you charge a lot more for it. That's what eBay does, for example. I saw recently for their Muhammad Ali NFTs. They were sold out, selling their most limited edition one for $2,500 per NFT. They all sold. All right, so the be on the lookout item of the week is air conditioning parts. Air conditioning repair services are turning to eBay and Amazon to find parts. There is a nationwide shortage. They can't find them from their normal supplier, so that's where they're going. All right, eBay has decided to bring their eBay Open Seller Conference back in 2022 as a hybrid event. So that means there's going to be an in-person component and a virtual component, but for the vast majority of people, it will be virtual. You can sign up at specific events in New York, Austin, and Los Angeles. According to eBay, you're going to want to register for those quickly because the spots will probably fill up fast. Based on prior experience from people that I know who have gone to these types of events, it's really more of a networking opportunity as opposed to something that you're going to learn a lot of brand new information from. But if you're interested in it, you know, just wanted you to be aware of this latest update. All right, now as an update to a story I shared with you last week in which eBay sent flocks of representatives over to China to teach them how to sell on eBay, which is of course going to compete with US sellers. They have now announced four sellers in the Asia Pacific region that they can now sign up for a FedEx account to facilitate shipping internationally. So it's an important thing for US sellers to be aware of because you are going to be facing more and more competition from global trade. I'm not saying global trade is a bad thing as long as it's fair trade, but you do need to be aware that there's going to be more and more competition on the platform from international sellers. All right, so what is not good for trade, particularly in the Pokemon reselling card business, would be flooding the market with 9 billion more trading cards. And that's exactly what the Pokemon company did in response to decreased supply and increased demand that happened during the pandemic. It was very, very difficult for collectors to find the cards and was getting people very upset. So the response was to produce 9 billion of the cards. And yes, that's super effective in making more product available. It's readily available on the shelves. That's a problem, though, for the reselling community because we do best when there's increased demand but low supply. And now with the market being flooded, you know, that really just drives the prices down on a lot of the cards. Don't get me wrong. There's still cards that will go for good money. But overall, I don't think it's good news in general. All right. So in another Whatnot update, they have teamed with another celebrity, this time UFC fighter George Masvidal, to sell sports collectibles. So he's going to be selling sports cards and other types of products from his personal collection, as well as giving away four signed gloves. So I generally like with Whatnot is doing with their partnerships with celebrities. It's a great way to get fans to interact with their favorite celebrity, get some things from them directly. It's one of the cool things I like about the platform. So I just like to see them continue to innovate and move in this direction. And we'll see what other folks they could get to sign on with them. Last week, there was announcement of the publishing company. And they partner with a lot of great people in the comic industry, for example. So I just see this getting better and better over time. And you know, I'll just keep updating you as more things come out related to this. All right, so in our weird story of the week, Gene Simmons chewed gum was auctioned off on eBay for over $245,000. Almost a quarter of $1 million was supposed to go to a charity to help youth by getting them involved in football. Gene Simmons came up with this idea when he was getting ready to do some of his famous tongue tricks, and he removed his bubble gum, put it down on a piece of paper, and generously was going to give the piece of paper as part of the auction as well. I don't think that eBay actually sanctioned this auction once it went through. I think they may have actually blocked it. They definitely removed it because if you click on the link right there, you see that it is no longer available. So I'm not sure if they actually allowed the funds to get transferred. I wish these stories would follow up with that aspect of it because it's something we're usually left in the dark on. Just in case you were wondering, if you were thinking that you could go and just chew some bubble gum up and then just list it online. I mean, I don't think there'd be anyone who would buy Primetime Treasure Hunter chewed bubble gum. Maybe you'd buy a Mountain Dew bottle that I drank out of. I don't know. But if you look at the food policy, you know, it says you can't sell expired food. That's not technically what they mean, you know, with chewed bubble gum. They mean things that have an expiration date on it. But if you look at what food items are allowed, it does say that you need to ensure that the food items are properly packaged and stored safely, that you clearly state the expiration date in the item description, and that you state how perishable items would be delivered. It doesn't seem like chewed bubble gum is something that is in the spirit of these policy guidelines. So not something that I would suggest doing. All right, everyone. Well, that's a wrap. Let me know what you thought of those news stories down below in the comment section. I always love to see your reactions and responses. I'm starving, though. Mrs. Primetime just let me know that the pizza has arrived. So I got to go dig in. Hopefully nothing explodes on the way over. All right, everyone. Take care.